I'll never apologize for the United States of America.
Ever.
I don't care what the facts are.
Why are we going to sit down and talk to these quote-unquote moderate rebels?
Who are the truly moderate rebels?
The search for the moderate rebel. Do these moderate rebels exist?
Moderate
rebels.
You are listening to and watching maybe Moderate Rebels. I'm here with Max Blumenthal, and today we're going to talk about a few different issues that are closely related. There have been violent protests going on in Nicaragua for the past 2 months, but there's not much context for what's been happening, especially the historical context of U.S. meddling and supporting brutal right-wing death squads, and also the U.S. regime change arm, the National Endowment for Democracy, and the key role that the NED has played in supporting a lot of these opposition groups as they're going on paid junkets to Washington, D.C. to meet with the most right-wing Republicans in the Congress. But also at the same time, we're going to talk about another related issue, which is the horrors we've seen on the southern border, where immigrant children have been separated from their parents. And rightfully, there has been a lot of liberal condemnation of the Trump administration, which might reverse that policy. But at the same time, there isn't much historical context for why is there this immigration from Central America, which is actually, it's not even at the peak. There's this impression that it's like out of control, but it's actually low compared to how it's been in the past. And also, what role has the Democratic Party played in creating this? And we can go back to Bill Clinton, but also Barack Obama, who deported more people than any other president. And of course, what are the policies that are pursued by these parties economically that are fueling a lot of this? So today we're going to talk about all of those related issues.
Yeah. Before we do that, just a quick announcement, because not enough of you are supporting our Patreon at patreon.com/moderaterebels. We've had to turn to the pharmaceutical industry for donations. And so we have a responsibility and an obligation to show this ad from one of our donors in Big Pharma.
So you partied all night and woke up with red eyes. You stayed up late to watch the late, late, and the much too late show. Our special formula spreads soothing, cooling moisture to your eyes in politically convenient circumstances. Maddow's Tears. Maddow's Tears will fill your eyes with moisture when Donald Trump puts immigrant children in cages. And it will even make those dry eyes misty when a Russian troll farm gets indicted. Maddow's Tears. Restrictions apply. Maddow's Tears may not produce moisture under democratic presidencies. Tears may not occur for Palestinian children killed by U.S. armed Israeli forces, Yemeni children killed by U.S.-backed Saudi forces, Afghan children killed by U.S. military personnel, or black children killed by cops. Maddow's Tears. Let the ratings flow.
Look for Maddow's Tears at a store near you.
Produces politically convenient moisture. I've actually found the display of Maddow crying, just to be totally cynical, and it was obviously fake. Like, I'm just going to come out and say it. Like, it was fake tears, and like anyone who tried to like pump up Maddow's fake tears is like just as is a dupe at best. She's a total charlatan. There weren't even any tears in her eyes. Like, just look at her eyes. There are no tears. She actually doesn't care about immigrant children. And she almost cried over the indictment of this Russian troll farm, which, by the way, the indictment, and she said at the end of that episode that the defendants will never appear in court. But since they did appear in court and demanded discovery, Mueller is not actually going to be convicting them. And he's passing the case off to other lawyers. And there may never be a conviction. The indictment was a complete joke. But Maddow got really emotional for that, too. She's doing it for ratings. It's all for ratings. The freak out is over now. But the issue, the very real issue of not just family separation, but the brutalization of immigrants by this country, and just the brutalization of the population living south of our border, continues. And so, I mean, we have different issues to unpack here. I've covered immigration issues since I started out in journalism in like 2002, and I've spent a lot of time on the border. I lived in LA for 5 years, so I know a lot of the, you know, I know a lot of the reasons why people came here from Mexico and El Salvador. I spent like almost a year off and on in Mexico, and about 6 months, five or six months in Nicaragua as well, which is a country that has a totally different story. And I think we have to unpack a lot of these issues. They're not obviously going to be put in context in cable media. We did see a lot on Twitter, on left Twitter, of information highlighting the role of Democrats in the crisis. And I think that's important, but it also provided Republicans with a way of saying, well, they did it too. So, you know, you can't just blame Trump here. I think the Democrats, let me just first say that I think we've week after week since Trump has been president, there's been some kind of liberal freakout. A lot of it has been manufactured. Much of it, actually, I'd say most of it has moved the helped move the Democratic Party and the American public in general to the right, mostly on foreign policy because of Russiagate. In this case, you had an actual issue, a very real issue being brought into the open. Basically, there was a debate within the Obama administration around 2014 about what to do with all these child migrants who were coming across the border, many of them unaccompanied. And we'll talk about why they were coming across the border in a second. The Obama administration decided, well, we'll detain them. We'll detain the shit out of them. And then we're going to send Jay Johnson and, you know, our DHS secretary down to Guatemala to give speeches to Spanish media, warning these children and their families not to come up because we're going to send them back. Then we're going to deport all these children, including the unaccompanied minors. And Hillary Clinton did defend that policy. But they didn't decide to separate those children from their parents in custody. And the Trump administration not only made the decision to do that under Stephen Miller, who's kind of like Trump's outsourced brain on immigration and has been an anti-immigrant activist since he lived in Santa Monica and just apparently hated Latino people who were all around him there, and was at Santa Monica High School and just decided to be this kind of one of these kind of like upper middle class racist conservatives who are like the worst kind of people in our society.
Look at that guy. He's just a sociopath. Stephen Miller. Yeah.
But it's like a way of being a rebel when you're around liberals all the time is like, I'm going to be a racist, even though I'm basically one of them. Stephen Miller like was proud of this. He gained like libidinal satisfaction from seeing images of children separated from their parents. And so the Democrats and like MSDNC decided to make an issue of it for once to talk about a real issue. And it really worked because Trump's approval ratings had gone up to 45%. They fell, like they did something successful. And I'd say, you know, like, let's talk about, there are like 12 more crazy issues just like this. Like the Trump administration wants to triple the rent on people in low income housing because Ben Carson has said that they're too lazy and that it'll teach them a lesson. But, you know, we're not going to go that far. In any case, it brought out the immigration crisis for everyone to see and the draconian nature of the U.S. government's handling of it, particularly ICE. ICE is just kind of like the tip of the iceberg.
And what's been very interesting and amazing to see is how there are even elements of the Democratic Party, specifically these kinds of insurgent left-wing progressives, people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who is likely going to be a new congresswoman in New York. Also, even Cynthia Nixon, who's running against Cuomo for governor of New York, who are running as Democrats, they and others have even called for the abolition of ICE. So it has inspired this kind of good grassroots movement on the left, although, of course, many of these mainstream Democrats are refusing to get on board with that. The impression is this is some kind of radical policy. I mean, we can talk maybe more about ICE, but ICE was created by the Bush administration after 9/11. This is actually less than 20 years old.
And it's become kind of a Praetorian political guard for Trump, which is why it's kind of it's become a soft target for people on the left. I think, you know, calling for abolishing ICE is a good idea, but at the end of the day, it's just going to be reincorporated into something like the INS, which existed before Bush, and even some ICE agents are now coming out and saying, yeah, abolish us, and you'll just reorganize our agency.
Well, under CBP, Customs and Border Protection.
But it's just going to be a rebranding, like when Blackwater became Z, and the problem will continue to fester. But it was a good way for Ocasio to distinguish herself from Crowley in a debate when he's like considered pretty progressive, but he's not really left. In any case, I think one of the things that hasn't been discussed, and it's actually given Trump a political advantage, is the context behind the immigration crisis. And it is a crisis. It's a crisis for migrants, first of all, who don't actually want to just, they're not here to enjoy the American way of life. They're being forced from their communities and their homes because of economic warfare, because of imperialism, because of the drug war, because of instability. And it's the fault of this country in almost every case. And that really isn't discussed. And it's what has allowed everyone from Donald Trump to like Ed Gillespie, who is this hack corporate Republican who ran for governor in Virginia, to exploit the MS-13 issue, which is also a real issue. I mean, I live in DC, and like in the suburbs of DC, there are people who are terrified of MS-13, but we don't talk about why MS-13 exists. You can only understand it within the framework of empire. You know, I mean, when you talk about MS-13, you have to understand the Contras and the civil wars that took place in the 1980s. When you talk about MS-13, I would recommend everyone listening to this, watch, there's a film called Voces Inocentes, Innocent Voices. It's about the civil war in El Salvador. It's the best film made about it. And, you know, if you rent it, there's English subtitles. But it really shows what we did to that country through our proxy forces. We were arming the Contras and this far-right Arena party in El Salvador to carry out hundreds of thousands of killings through death squads and crush what was really a nationalist insurgency oriented around socialism to get out of the yoke of the U.S., which had just kept El Salvador as like a fruit farm for American consumers and not allowed them to develop an independent economy. Today, El Salvador exists on remittances. Much of its population lives in Washington, D.C., which is pretty ironic. They were sort of like refugees who were granted asylum in many cases. But what happened was that we created a refugee crisis by not letting them have an independent government and funding death squads. The refugees, many of them were child soldiers who had been militarized. They come to an unfamiliar environment where they're the poorest of the poor. In LA, they're poorer than Mexicans. They have to organize in their own communities. And they go to prison, becoming further militarized and hardened. And then the U.S., through the Department of Justice in the 90s, the darkest days of the Department of Justice, when the mass deportation policies really came into force under Bill Clinton, starts deporting anyone who commits a felony who's an undocumented immigrant. So people who've been inculcated into the gang culture in the U.S., who had already been militarized and traumatized by these wars, are dumped back by the thousands into El Salvador, and we destabilize that entire country all over again. That's where MS-13 comes from. Similar situation happened in Guatemala, where we and Israel armed their death squads under Efraim Rios Montt, who was a protege of Pat Robertson. He's sort of like this Christian right dictator who carried out a genocide against Mayans in Guatemala in the 80s. We deported tons of felons there. And now they have a resurgence of death squad activity in Guatemala, who are basically vigilantes who are killing gang members. And so the bodies of anyone who has like a spider tattoo, like a Marisol Trucha type tattoo, are piling up in Guatemala City. It's another horrible situation we created. We haven't even talked about Mexico yet and what we've done to them. But once we start talking about this, then we can start pushing back on Trump's racist rhetoric on MS-13. But until we start talking about empire, there's really no way to understand them except the way that Trump wants us to, which is as animals.
Yeah, there's actually a really good article that explains some of the context for this that was published in The Nation in 2016 by Raymond Bunner, in which he's calling for the U.S. to officially apologize to El Salvador. This was after President Obama, then he had just apologized for the U.S. support of the Dirty War in Argentina, where the U.S. backed a brutal right-wing military dictatorship. But then he looks at El Salvador and says that we need to have a similar apology. He points out that the U.S. played an active role in the Dirty War in El Salvador in the 1980s, which pitted a right-wing government against Marxist guerrillas. The U.S. sent military advisors to help the Salvadoran military fight this war, as well as hundreds of millions of dollars of economic and military aid. He points out that in Argentina, the brutal security forces killed 30,000 civilians. In El Salvador, more than 75,000 people lost their lives in the Civil War, which lasted from 1980 to 1992. And according to the United Nations Truth Commission, committed numerous atrocities, including they were responsible for more than 85% of the killings, kidnappings, and torture. So that's to say, the U.S.-backed right-wing government forces in El Salvador in the 1980s carried out 85% of the killings, kidnappings, and torture. And Raymond Bunner points out, the United States went well beyond remaining largely silent in the face of human rights abuses in El Salvador. The State Department and White House often sought to cover up the brutality to protect the perpetrators of even the most heinous crimes. He, of course, speaks about the killing of Archbishop Oscar Romero, who was a well-known left-wing Catholic.
He was a liberation theology preacher, and the CIA had an active program of demolishing liberation theology because they considered it sort of crypto-communism.
Yeah, and this actually came up also when Trump demonized Latin America as a so-called hellhole. And what's interesting is this whole talking point is addressed by a very good journalist. Hopefully we can have him on our show in the future, named Oscar Martinez. And he wrote a really good book called A History of Violence, which was published by Verso. And in it, he says everything in Latin America, quote, is tangled up with the U.S. And what's so incredible is he talks about specifically this issue of gangs, which, as Max mentioned, are not entirely indigenous groups to Latin America. He points out, this is Oscar Martinez writing in his book, A History of Violence, these gangs weren't born in Guatemala or Honduras or El Salvador. They came from the United States, Southern California to be precise. They began with migrants fleeing U.S.-sponsored war, and in fleeing, some of these young men found themselves living in an ecosystem of gangs already established in California, and so they came together to defend themselves, and they established a name. And then Oscar Martinez continues, and he says, by the end of the 1980s and the beginning of the 1990s, a few experts, member of Congress, and a president came up with a stupendous idea about how to get rid of these gangs. With the logic of an ape, they decided the problem could simply be booted to the other side of the border. They acted like a scared child who closes his eyes in the hope that what frightens him will simply disappear. And it was in these years that about 4,000 gang members, all with criminal records, were deported. They were sent to countries at war. Those 4,000 are now 60,000 just in El Salvador alone.
Yeah, it's like the reverse of the Marieleta boat lift from Cuba that caused a giant crime wave in Miami, on steroids. So you just take all of these traumatized people like fireflies, put them in a jar, shake them up, and then dump them on the other side of the border and build a wall. And it wasn't Trump who started to build the wall. I mean, no one even talks about this either, or you don't hear much about how the wall started to be built. There is a wall on the border, and there have been record deaths on the border because of that wall. So we also have to talk about the U.S.-Mexico border to understand the crisis and why. And we have to talk about contemporary Central American policy, specifically Honduras, to understand the child migration crisis. But let's take it from, I guess, the 90s, following the first real amnesty for undocumented immigrants, which brought so many families and people out into the open and enabled Mexicans especially in Los Angeles, to really start building a middle class and becoming making LA what it really is today. And it was Ronald Reagan's amnesty. And following Reagan and Bush started getting more active in Latin America. He sort of destroyed Panama. The drug war began. Delta Force was involved in the killing of Pablo Escobar, which actually caused further instability in Colombia.
And what's incredible about this story is Pablo Escobar's son actually just recently published a book in which he talked about how Pablo Escobar was working with the CIA there as well. So again, we see the U.S. fueling different sides of these conflicts and creating more and more instability, just like the Middle East.
Absolutely. You know, you can, if you want to get granular with it, it's going to give you a headache. I mean, it's really didn't just, it's at every layer, it's like an onion. And if you keep peeling the onion, like by the center, there's just this magma core of pure evil. But, you know, just to keep it macro, you know, Clinton comes in the 90s, 1992, and one of the first things he does is pass NAFTA. The New York Times published its editorial board, of course, supported NAFTA. They support anything that's free trade. And they admitted in their editorial endorsing NAFTA that 2/3 of the country of Mexico will be badly hurt by it. That's mostly like the rural population, but also the middle class. The rural population of Mexico was devastated by NAFTA. And this was continuing a process that began under JFK called Seeds of Peace, where the U.S. would just dump all of its surplus agricultural goods and its seeds on Mexico and the global south and devastate its farm economy. And it was partly a counterinsurgency campaign because the U.S. feared that that revolutionary bands would start organizing the peasantry as they did in Cuba. So they wanted to basically decimate the peasantry. So NAFTA comes in. The model is outsource U.S. jobs. The Levi Strauss plant in El Paso, which is unionized, employed mostly like a Chicana workforce, goes over the border the next day. All the union jobs in, like, I mean, you're talking about like 8,000 to 10,000 union jobs in El Paso, go to Ciudad Juarez. The first article I ever wrote was a piece from Ciudad Juarez on the mass femicides. And like I visited a mass grave where 13 young girls had been found. They were sweatshop workers. They worked in the maquiladoras assembling things like Levi's jeans. And no one knew really why they were being murdered. There was just so many murders. Some were being carried out by cops, some by, you know, deranged people, some by, you know, drug cartels. And basically by this point, because of the killing of Escobar and the focus on Colombia, the drug shipping lines had redirected through Juarez. So there was a massive cartel in Juarez, which was actively overtaking whatever government was there and destabilizing the north, and in Tijuana. And they were fighting one another in this massive blood feud. So because of NAFTA, which forced the rural population north to these maquiladoras where there was the only economy, and because of the drug war, northern Mexico became completely destabilized, and the pressure on the border, the U.S.-Mexico border, was enormous. There were meanwhile hundreds of deaths in places like Arizona, which is why you started to see the Minutemen and the rise of the anti-immigrant movement in Arizona, where these border vigilantes would go out. And I went out and actually reported on the first wave, the sort of first generation of border vigilantes. These people played a critical role in bringing Trump into office and putting a campaign like that on the map. But this is, we're back in 2004. Why were these people in Arizona in the desert chasing down migrants? Because in the 90s, in the late 80s and the early 90s, most people crossed the U.S.-Mexico border through Tijuana and through Juarez. And actually, a lot of people would, like, they'd just cross on rafts the Rio Grande, and some of them would go to their jobs in El Paso and come home to Juarez at night. People would go back and forth across the border, and it was just part of the culture. And, you know, the white people who lived in El Paso and a lot of these other towns like Laredo or Brownsville didn't have that racist attitude because they just come from the culture of the border. But Bill Clinton comes in and does Operation Gatekeeper under pressure from actually his right, from right-wing Republicans who run Congress, and this movement that started in San Diego called Turn on the Lights in like 1993. These racist white people from San Diego would set up their cars on the border and turn on their lights. And they were just staying there in this grassroots anti-immigrant protest until Bill Clinton agreed to build the wall. And he built the wall in Tijuana and around Tijuana. He built the wall in all of the main border cities and destroyed the culture of the border with these walls, militarized the border massively, which has led us to the rise of ICE, and forced migrants who wanted to come into the country, whether to reunite with their families, to find work, or to escape the instability that we had caused in their communities, they had to cross through the desert, which is treacherous. I mean, in the summer, you're talking about 120 degrees of heat. A lot of activists from like No More Deaths in Tucson have been putting out water for them, and the water tanks and water bottles get dumped out and shot by Border Patrol agents.
Well, and some of these activists are now even being arrested.
Yeah, and they're being arrested. So the whole crisis starts then and there, and it really starts under a Democratic president. I really believe that that you can draw a straight line between these policies and the rise of Trump. And these policies are an outgrowth of our whole relationship with Latin America, which goes back to the Monroe Doctrine.
And the idea that the U.S. owns the countries to its south. And throughout the Cold War, we saw just the peak of this. I mean, just the extreme violence. Max mentioned the war in Guatemala. What's interesting is in the U.S., there's this notion of American exceptionalism, but also not just that, there's this notion that American lives are more valuable, and therefore that when there's violence here, it's somehow more important than violence elsewhere. So, of course, you know, when we saw in 9/11 the blowback of decades of the U.S. support for these far-right extremist Islamist groups and the creation of al-Qaeda in Afghanistan in the 1980s, and we saw the blowback where 3,000 innocent Americans were killed for no reason, and we're rightfully told never forget or never again. But at the same time, there are these wars that happened in the 80s and 90s where hundreds of thousands of people were killed. That's really recent. That's within our lifetimes. And there's no awareness of it. And people are just say, oh, forget about it, get over it. But like looking at Guatemala, I mean, I was getting this up earlier when we were talking about the role the U.S. has played in destabilizing specifically Central America, where a lot of these contra wars were waged. Nicaragua is talked about, but let's look at Guatemala, where Max mentioned Rios Montt, the brutal dictator who committed genocide and was in fact facing a second genocide trial when he died recently. Rios Montt enjoyed staunch support from the U.S. and specifically the CIA during the Guatemalan Civil War as his brutal regime just murdered and raped large numbers of communists and indigenous Guatemalans, specifically the Maya. And an independent commission that was called for by the United Nations, this is independent, not linked to a government, found that the U.S.-backed Guatemalan military regime, led by Rios Montt, was responsible for 93% of civilian killings. 93%, whereas 3% were carried out by the Marxist rebels. So, again, 3% of civilians killed in this brutal two-decade war in Guatemala were carried out by the communists, who were told were the, you know, godless communists who don't care about civilians, whereas almost 100 or 93% of the 42,000 civilian killings were carried out by the U.S.-backed forces. I mean, and we're supposed to, and this was in the 80s, like, people still remember this.
Yeah, and it wasn't just the U.S., it was Israel. Guatemala was directly armed by Israel, trained by Israeli soldiers. I think Rios Montt said our soldiers have adopted the Israeli way of war. He said so openly. The primitive computer that was exported to Guatemala, it was a computer. It was basically a database of activists and people who needed to be liquidated, was provided by Israel. The reason that the U.S., we turned to Israel, was because of the Boland Amendment, which was an amendment in the House that was passed, and it was part of intelligence reform, something that, you know, we're probably never going to have again because of the excesses and crimes committed in Vietnam, which forced, but it was also related to the Contra Wars. You know, back then there were actually people in Congress who opposed these secret proxy wars and actually could mobilize a serious opposition. And the Boland Amendment forced the executive, the president, to put his or her signature on any secret covert activity so that they would have to take the ultimate responsibility. So they just said, okay, we don't want to put our signature on this and acknowledge it's happening. So Israel, you know, help us out here, demonstrate why you're our friend in the Cold War. So this is also, you know, the result of Israel's influence around the world.
Yeah, and getting back to Max's point about how this is a bipartisan problem that was created, and that the Democratic Party has a key role in this. What's interesting is in 2016, I published an article in Salon about a largely ignored Human Rights Watch report. And for listeners, Human Rights Watch, if you don't know, it has a revolving door with the U.S. government, clearly an extremely pro-U.S. bias. I did a report at Gray Zone looking at how, especially their Latin America coverage, which is just atrocious. They spend more than half of their time focusing on Venezuela.
They're openly campaigning for regime change and fundraising off of it, and they have a hashtag to support regime change. So.
Exactly. You go to their homepage, and this thing saying, support the Venezuelan opposition comes up, blah, blah, blah. So they're certainly, they have an extremely pro-U.S. bias, and they're supportive of many of these U.S. policies. But even they acknowledged in 2016, there was a report titled U.S.:20 Years of Immigrant Abuses. And specifically, it's looking at, in 1996, Bill Clinton signed two immigration laws. It wasn't just Bill Clinton's fault. I mean, these were laws passed by the Congress, but he ultimately signed them and approved them. And Human Rights Watch is actually campaigning, saying the U.S. should repeal these two laws. And Human Rights Watch says explicitly, quote, these immigration laws have subjected hundreds of thousands of people to arbitrary detention, fast-track deportations, and family separation. And then the report later points out that over the last two decades, these laws, quote, rip apart the families of even long-term legal residents. So it's important to understand that, yes, the Trump administration is ramping up this horrific war on immigrants, and Trump is an extreme racist. I mean, he makes it clear every time he speaks. This is also a bipartisan problem, and we can't pretend like MSDNC, as Max joked, that these outlets that were silent, as the Obama administration deported more people than any other president, that's 2.7 million people, we can't pretend like these liberal MIC resistance types are actually going to solve this problem.
So yeah, I was actually in 2014, I was in Tacoma, Washington. I was on a book tour for my book Goliath. And, you know, I learned that at the local immigrant prison, which was run by ICE, and it was a private prison. It wasn't run by ICE. It was actually run by the GEO Group, was a private prison company. There was a hunger strike, and all these people were basically being pulled off the streets by ICE agents and asked for the ID. And in many cases, they'd be thrown in the jail and their kids would just be turned over to orphanages. And so the inmates in this prison, it was the Northwest Detention Center, I'd go out and meet people who were asking wondering where their family members were for days until they found out they were in this prison. You know, this was taking place under Obama with DHS maintaining a bed quota. Under the Obama administration, the Department of Homeland Security had a bed quota, which meant that 30,000 beds in privatized prisons had to be filled with undocumented immigrants across the country. There were Democrats in Congress who tried to fight this and introduced reform measures. I don't think they ever passed. But I mean, I couldn't get anyone to really, I mean, it wasn't really a national issue that people were really talking about. And GEO Group, people are talking about it now because of the, you know, child separation crisis that, you know, cable news and the Democrats finally decided to discuss. But they're not just funding Republicans, they're funding people like Ted Lieu, who's like become this comic book resistance Democrat. The GEO Group put one of its lobbyists on the DNC Platform Planning Commission, who is a Hillary Clinton stalwart. So they have their people in both parties, and we can't just talk about this as a partisan issue. I'm sorry, but like the reason that we need to talk about Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama being such monsters on immigration, particularly Obama, and we can talk about Hillary in Honduras in a second, but particularly Obama, is to make sure this never happens again under a Democrat. They just need to be completely shamed. And like, I just know that from my experience in American politics, right-wingers only respond to force and liberals only respond to shame. So they need to be shamed.
Yeah, that's a good rule of thumb. No, but what's wild about this is I remember very vividly throughout the Obama administration, regular protests held by immigrants' rights groups. And, you know,
yeah, chaining themselves to buses containing children. And, you know, it was crazy.
Well, yeah, but I was going to say where, you know, Latino groups would call rightfully Obama deporter in chief. I mean, Obama was the deporter in chief. And that's just been totally erased. And Obama himself is enjoying this positive press coverage where, you know, he's criticizing Trump's immigration policies rightfully.
Yeah, and Michelle Obama and Laura Bush, whose husband created ICE.
No, but yeah, I mean, but these people
should be like shamed out of existence. Like, what the hell? Not out of existence, but they should be shamed publicly.
What does that mean? Yeah, just to be clear, I don't really know what that means, but
they can exist.
No, but what's incredible is this point about privatized prisons is paramount. This was spearheaded, to be fair, under Bush, specifically, and there's been an interesting confluence, and private prison companies have really profited off of this strategically in the war on terror era, where there was an attempt to combine the war on terror rhetoric and discourse with the immigration crisis of these children crossing the border, etc. So these privatized prison companies, Geo Group and others, were using this to say, okay, well, we have issues with border security, which also is going to threaten our own national security. There were even ridiculous reports that, like, ISIS was going to cross over the Mexico border. I mean, just outlandish nonsense. But this was, of course, used to justify bed quotas and these draconian policies, which were largely expanded under Obama. And it was Obama whose administration really expanded the private prison industry. And toward the end, as with many things in his last 2 years, Obama tried to leave a more positive liberal legacy.
And he did DACA, which went nowhere.
Yeah, and he tried to, you know, slap the DOJ on the wrist and say, okay, well, the DOJ is not going to use private prisons, although that's just 10% of the facilities in which immigrants are incarcerated and other folks are incarcerated. It was symbolic mostly. And it's true that Jeff Sessions has actually moved away from that. And Jeff Sessions is, again, intensifying the use of privatized prisons. But this is a bipartisan policy, and we absolutely cannot ignore the role that Democrats have played in supporting the profiting off of putting immigrants in cages. Like, private companies are making huge sums of money just putting these people who are fleeing U.S.-sponsored violence, economic instability, their local economies have been destroyed by NAFTA. You have large American multinational conglomerates who have taken over local economies in Mexico and in other parts of Central America. They're fleeing poverty. They're fleeing U.S.-fueled violence. And then they're coming, crossing the U.S. border, and then being interned by these companies that are making money off of it. I mean, it's just so outrageous, and we can't understand it without understanding all of these factors and how it's profitable. It's not just a matter of Trump being a racist bigot, which he is, but it's also that there are lots of people whose jobs are to make money off of the internment of these human beings.
Yeah, I mean, Geo Group stocks have gone surged this week, and the stock market is down. Geo Group stocks are way up to record levels. But look, we interned some folks, okay? Complicated. I didn't want to do it. Congress made me do it. I take no responsibility for it. And I'm going to leave with some symbolic things. We don't need to love our neighbors and respect each other. I certainly respect Richard Branson on his boat. We had a paddle... We had a splash fight, but like I loved James Mattis the most when he gave his recent speech at the Shangri-La, slamming China and Russia. And he said that Putin is, determined to undermine our moral authority. And then a day later, the Pentagon announces that it is going to take 20,000 immigrant families and put them on cages in military bases.
On bases. As if that solves the problem somehow.
Under Jim... But it's really Putin who's undermining our moral authority, not the Pentagon and the U... I mean, Did Putin make them do that?
And then, of course, we'd be remiss when we're talking about the bipartisan nature of this war on immigrants. And it's a war on immigrants, it really is, that's been going on for decades. We'd be remiss if we don't mention Hillary Clinton. And specifically, when this crisis, although, again, I still think, I mean, we can talk about what it means for an immigration crisis. I still think this is largely a media manufactured thing, specifically by the right. If you look at the total number of immigrants crossing the U.S. border, it's actually lower than it's been in years. It's not at the lowest point, but it's been decreasing, partially because of all these draconian measures adopted by both Republican and Democratic administrations. But anyway, 4 years ago, when you had Central American children crossing the U.S. border, Hillary Clinton, then Secretary of State, staunchly defended the Obama administration policy of deporting these children. And this came up 2 years ago. I remember it very vividly in February in 2016 during the primary debates between Bernie Sanders and Hillary. And, you know, Bernie Sanders wasn't great in a lot of issues, and he was a bit weak in immigration, but he rightfully brought this issue up and sparred with Clinton over it. And in the February 2016 presidential debate, he said,
Secretary Clinton, I do have a disagreement here. If my memory is correct, I think when we saw children coming from these horrendously violent areas of Honduras, and neighboring countries, people who are fleeing drug violence and cartel violence, I thought it was a good idea to allow those children to stay in this country. That was not, as I understand it, the Secretary's position.
So that was a clip in which Sanders called out Hillary Clinton for supporting the deportation of these child refugees.
Well, she actually, in an interview, defended it. And, you know, I think, you know, people understand that she defended it, but what people don't understand, and maybe you can talk about this more, is the direct connection between this particular aspect of the crisis, if we can call it that, and what Hillary Clinton did in Honduras.
Absolutely. And there's no mention of this either when we talk about the historical context. In 2009, right when Obama came into office, the Obama administration backed a military coup in Honduras in which Manuel Zelaya, who was a left-wing president, who actually wasn't even, he wasn't that hard of a socialist, he wasn't even that left-wing at first, and he moved to the left as he went into office, which is rare because usually it's the opposite that happens. And the U.S. backed a military coup, and Zelaya was physically removed from the country.
Yeah.
So after that, after the Obama administration supported a military coup against an elected left-wing president in Honduras, and by the way, Hillary Clinton later supported this, although what's funny is during the 2016 presidential campaign, she actually had the editors remove some of the quotes about Honduras from her memoir to try to erase this history. But after that, after the 2009 coup, the murder rate continuously increased in Honduras until it had the ignominious honor of having the highest murder rate in the entire world. And there were numerous activists like Berta Cáceres, who was a feminist environmentalist who won many mainstream human rights awards. She was murdered in Honduras by forces that we later discovered were linked to the U.S. government, that were trained by the U.S. government. And this state violence has increased. In fact, in 2017, again, we saw another kind of soft coup in which the current president, Juan Orlando Hernandez, known as, they call him Ho, like J-O-H, he murdered dozens of protesters, and there was very little media coverage. What's incredible is this was happening at the same time as the protests in Venezuela, where you have right-wing violent insurgents trying to topple the elected government in Venezuela, overthrow Maduro, nonstop, wall-to-wall, 24/7 mainstream American media coverage. At the same time, there were American-backed military forces. These are cops and soldiers in Honduras who had been trained and received support from the U.S. who were murdering protesters who were protesting against the stolen election. And this is very well documented. Even the OAS, which has a very pro-U.S. bias, even they had to acknowledge that this election was stolen in 2017. So since 2009, the U.S. has backed at least two coups, one military coup and one kind of soft coup, which has destabilized the country, led to the largest, the highest murder rate in the world, and led to this wave of refugees and immigrants who have been fleeing to the U.S. But we never hear that context. Instead, immigration is always portrayed as this kind of moral play, this morality play. And even Democrats do this. Republicans
should we be good people and welcome our neighbors or not? How about we stop fucking with their countries?
Exactly. Republicans portray it as, oh, I mean, this is all just the bleeding heart liberals who just want to welcome in, you know, immigrants to our country. And yeah, we should, you know, welcome in people to our country, but also we should stop destabilizing their countries and making them immigrants and refugees in the first place, because they don't want to leave their houses. They don't want to leave their families. They don't want to, you know, just move to a new land where they don't speak the language well, where they're not documented and they're going to live as a permanent underclass.
You mean they don't want to come here and benefit from our incredible healthcare system?
No, exactly. I mean, and what's wild is, I mean, as you know, El Salvador, Nicaragua, Honduras, these countries have a lot of issues, but honestly, their healthcare is still probably better than ours. But again, everybody, like the Democrats, the mainstream, you know, neoliberal Democrats frame this entirely as a moral issue, saying, oh, we have to welcome these people. And it's not just a moral issue, it's a political issue. And we have to talk about why these people are made refugees and migrants, because it's very similar to the refugee crisis in Europe. Why are there so many Syrian refugees? Why are there Iraqi refugees and Libyan refugees? It's because their countries have been destroyed by US-backed NATO wars. And it's very similar to Latin America. There's a reason that if you look at the rates of violence in Central America and Mexico, the rates of violence actually parallel the rates of violence in the Middle East, in these regions that have been destabilized, like Afghanistan, that have been destabilized, and this is technically South Asia, but destabilized for decades by the US. And you look at where are the parts of the world where people are beheaded. People are beheaded, well, aside from Saudi Arabia, in which case it's the state, but people are beheaded in Syria and Iraq by ISIS, and then they're beheaded by far-right death squads who used to be backed by the CIA in Central America. They're beheaded by cartels who have links to the Mexican state and even to the US government. Like, these forms of violence are not indigenous and unique to Latin America or the Middle East. They're manifestations of the same political problems.
Yeah, I couldn't have said it any better. And I think, you know, this is obviously off limits to discuss for, I mean, it's very hard to even find articles in progressive media that are making these points for whatever reason. I guess it's because everyone feels, you know, kind of pinned down and up against the wall in the Trump era, and they just need to stop Trump. But the problem is not going to go away. There's only one country in Central America. The problem isn't going to go away until we change our whole way of interacting with Latin America and the Middle East. And we should learn some lessons from the consequences of our regime change and destabilization policies. But there's one country, you know, that has sort of resisted the U.S. on different levels, and it doesn't have the same migration crisis. It's Nicaragua. I actually have a clip from a 1990 broadcast by ABC where they reference an ABC News poll that backs this up in 1990 and shows that most people in the country were actually very happy with the Sandinista government, and Daniel Ortega, then president, had high approval ratings. So you can play that clip.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings.
Good evening. We begin tonight with some facts and figures from Nicaragua that are going to surprise many Americans. This Sunday, when the people of Nicaragua vote in their first free election in a decade, they will most likely elect as president the man Washington loves to hate. More than half of all Nicaraguans like the way Ortega has been running the country. A majority trust the Sandinistas to run a fair election. Most say the Sandinistas have done an excellent or a good job in dealing with Nicaragua's problems. Despite all the emphasis in the U.S. on the war between the Contras and the government, 3 out of every 4 Nicaraguans say the economy is their biggest concern. Only 13% mention the Contras as the biggest problem. The poll says a lot about how Nicaraguans think of the U.S. More than half think the opposition takes its orders from Washington. 72% are angry the U.S. has supported the Contras. And while a majority of people in Latin America usually say they would like to move to the U.S. for better economic opportunities, 7 out of 10 Nicaraguans say they would never come here. A couple of other notes about our Nicaraguan poll. We designed the questions. The poll was conducted by the Washington pollsters Belden and Rusinello, who have a lot of experience in Latin America. It wasn't a phone poll. All the respondents wrote down their own answers in secret and apparently with great enthusiasm. And here is one more finding. 87% of the Nicaraguans we talked to said they were very concerned that the U.S. might invade their country.
Recent polling actually showed that Ortega, after coming back as president, making a lot of concessions, including to industry groups, to big business in Nicaragua, making concessions to the church. He's far from this firebrand leftist pure socialist, but he's president and he's got an independent foreign policy. He's working with Russia and China on various initiatives. The U.S. isn't totally happy with him, and he was very closely aligned with Venezuela, as well as Cuba, and the whole ALBA economy that had flourished when Hugo Chavez came in Venezuela. The U.S. started pumping money back into Nicaragua, where it had removed Ortega in 1990, and the reason that Ortega lost the election in 1990 was because people just wanted the civil war to end and they wanted the U.S. to stop screwing with them. So they were willing to elect this, ultra-conservative neoliberal government of, Violeta Chamorro, who's from one of the oligarchic families. So Ortega is now facing violent protests. There are roadblocks around the country choking the economy. A lot of people have died, mostly on the opposition side, but we have to understand that the opposition has been funded with millions of dollars in training and support for their NGOs and their various groups by the U.S. through the National Endowment for Democracy. I mean, over $4 million last year alone from the NED. USAID has pumped like over $5 million in, and they're actively trying to destabilize another country. And this is a country that is not contributing to the migration crisis, partly because a lot of people go to work just north in Costa Rica, but also partly because people are able to stay in their homes. And while they're very poor, there's healthcare, there's public healthcare, there's public education, there are public health clinics. I've spent time in Nicaragua. I didn't experience the same desire of people to go up to the U.S. that I did when I was in Mexico. So here we are again, trying to destabilize another country and contribute further to the crisis. It's time for people to look at the consequences or to look at the context of the policies that the U.S. enacts in Central America before they start trying to debate what to do with the people who are already here. It's time to be proactive.
Yeah, we'll actually do an episode devoted specifically to what's going on in Nicaragua sometime soon. So we don't want to go into it in too much detail here. But Max wrote a really good article in the Gray Zone Project. It's at grayzoneproject.com. And his article is called U.S. Government Meddling Machine Boasts of Laying the Groundwork for Insurrection in Nicaragua. That article has kind of gone viral. It's been reprinted a lot of places.
Nicaragua and South America as well.
Yeah, and what's interesting is, like Max said, he lived in Nicaragua for half a year, and we'll talk about it in the future in more detail. But really quickly, I just wanted to address one of the points we've heard in response to this piece, and in response to the interview Max did with me at The Real News. There are some people on the left. It reminds me a lot of what happened in Syria in 2011. And this is not to deny, again, that there were legitimate grievances in Syria. There certainly were. But the idea is, again, that these are progressive protests and that they can somehow lead to progressive change, as if they're not going to just destabilize the country and allow a right-wing U.S.-backed government to come in. And one of the pieces that was written that didn't mention Max but was clearly kind of based on this talking point and on the truth that the U.S. has played a key role, and the NED, the regime change arm, has played a key role in supporting these right-wing groups in Nicaragua. This was an article published by Rebecca Gordon at Tom Dispatch, which was reprinted in Truth out. And Rebecca Gordon's, I mean, she's done really good work on torture specifically. In fact, she has a really good book, maybe we should interview her, called American Nuremberg. And it's about, it's very clever, it's the officials who should stand trial for post-9/11 war crimes, in which she lays out, using international law, the American government officials who should be tried at the Hague, at the International Court of Justice or International Criminal Court. But anyway, she wrote this article that was reprinted by Truth Out, and she's pushing back against the leftists and just the journalists who are objective, who are pointing out the role the U.S. has played in destabilizing Nicaragua. And she's using a talking point that was used in Syria that we've heard.
Agency.
Rebecca Gordon wrote, "To blame everything that happens in the country on puppet masters in Washington denies Nicaraguans their own agency." And first of all, no one's doing that. I mean, of course, the whole framing is just obscene. Puppet masters in Washington, they're trying to delegitimize the whole notion of U.S. intervention. But what's amazing about this article is you read the article and it's a history of how the U.S. has destabilized Nicaragua. And then she has like three paragraphs saying, but today is different.
Yeah, well, it's because a lot of people who loved the Sandinistas in the 80s, they're of a different generation. They have an idealized view of them, and the Sandinistas aren't what they used to be because they don't have Soviet support anymore. And so they can't afford to do a lot of what they did. And Nicaragua has no natural resources. So, of course, any Sandinista government is going to make massive compromises. I don't know what these people want, but nothing's ever good enough for them. And they take such a condescending view to the left in Latin America these days. But that agency talking point, you know, I definitely heard that when I wrote about the White Helmets in Syria, which is not even actually a Syrian-run group.
No, and this is what's so outrageous.
What about the agency? And I'm like, well, what about the Central Intelligence Agency and the U.S. Agency for International Development? Because if it wasn't for those agencies, this unrest in Nicaragua wouldn't be happening. The catastrophe of Syria, where a rebellion was militarized and armed, wouldn't have happened. It wouldn't have happened. There's no debate. All right, that should be beyond debate. I mean, it was the CIA that armed them. What about those agencies?
Just this talking point is really dishonest. And what's wild is, again, none of us is denying that there are legitimate grievances. And like Max said, Ortega has, because of the politics of the situation, has had to have made massive concessions. Also, from the beginning, the Nicaraguan revolution, the Sandinista revolution, was not like the Cuban revolution, where the Cubans, they expropriated the wealth of the slave-owning capitalist class in Cuba, and most of the capitalists fled to Florida. They had a revolution in which they actually expropriated the wealth of the capitalist class. The Sandinistas were different. They had a more kind of social democratic revolution against a U.S.-backed dictator, Somoza. And in 1979, and after, when they formed what was called the Junta of National Reconstruction, if you look at what they did, the Sandinistas always had a very pragmatic element, and the Junta included elements of the business class who were kind of centrist, who were anti-Somoza, but they were not socialists, they were not revolutionaries. And always from the beginning, the Sandinistas had this kind of national democratic developmental mindset that we're going to help develop our country. We're a very tiny country with few resources, with a small economy. We're never going to be able to develop into this like independent socialist stalwart power. I don't know how people expect us to do that. So we're going to work with elements of the national bourgeoisie, elements of the, you know, democratic oriented liberal capitalist class. And that's always what they've done. And they've always made massive concessions. And what's amazing to me is that Rebecca Gordon in this article, she acknowledges the fact that for decades, you know, the U.S. was trying to destabilize Nicaragua. The U.S. funded fascist death squads, the Contras. And then she acknowledges, she says, Nicaraguans were not stupid. They knew that as long as the Sandinistas ran the government, the U.S. would continue its Contra war. So in 1990, Nicaraguans replaced the FSLN, that's the Sandinistas, with the UNO party run by Violeta Chamorro, in a result that shocked many people outside Nicaragua, including the Sandinistas' U.S. polling firm. The people had spoken and the Sandinistas accepted their verdict. She points out, that was momentous in itself. For the first time in history, a victorious revolutionary party allowed itself to be voted out of office. relinquishing many of its hopes, but preserving the democratic structures so many Nicaraguans had died to create and maintain. What's interesting about this two-paragraph passage here is it's in the middle of an article where she's saying that we need to ignore the U.S. role in destabilizing Nicaragua today because we're violating Nicaraguans' agency. But then she says openly, Nicaraguans knew that as long as the Sandinistas ran the government, the U.S. would continue its Contra war. So these people want the best of both worlds. They want Ortega to maintain some kind of fictitious socialist pure paradise where he's just going to like he's going to take all the rich people's wealth of the, and expropriate the Chamorro family, and then the U.S. is literally going to just invade. Like, what do they expect to happen? Like in Cuba, where the U.S. tried to assassinate Fidel 638 times and did launch an invasion, a failed invasion.
Yeah, you look at what it's doing to Venezuela's economy right now. I mean, it's as good as an invasion.
So they haven't
expropriated much. I mean, there are like country clubs that are pretty active in Venezuela.
And this is precisely why they haven't, because they were elected in. These people expect socialists to be elected in and then just to expropriate the rich. Like, no, people, these leaders are working within like bourgeois capitalist democratic frameworks. And Ortega, regardless of what you think about him, he was reelected in 2016 and he had 2/3 of the vote. And it was widely understood to be a fair and free election. The opposition largely conceded that. The opposition didn't have anything close to resembling the support he had. And again, this isn't, no one, even his supporters and the Sandinistas today in Nicaragua, they recognize the massive concessions that have been made. But what's outlandish is what Max just said, is that Nicaragua is one of the only remaining stable countries in the region that actually isn't contributing to the immigrants, the flow of immigrants and refugees coming to the U.S., but now the U.S. and both Republicans and Democrats and even self-declared socialists are begging for the country to be further destabilized. It's already been destabilized by violence and further fuel this immigrant and refugee crisis, similar to what we saw in Syria, that Trump and the far right will continue to exploit to gain more and more political power. Like, what do people expect to happen? We saw this again and again and again. We've seen it in the past several years with Libya and Syria and Europe, and it's only fueled the far right. It's fueled the AfD, which is a fascistic party in Germany, and it's fueled other far-right groups in France and the Netherlands, and it's going to do the same thing here, and Trump understands that.
Yeah, so excuse me if I talk about our agencies, but that's, you know, they've played a pretty critical role in the entire crisis we're talking about across the West, and the rise of the right is blowback. I want to make just one more point before we close, which is just a point about how this issue was manipulated by the Democrats. If I don't even know if manipulate is the best term, but it was kind of introduced. I think it kind of emerged somewhat spontaneously. But then the Democrats got a hold of the issue. I mean, the child separation issue, and it's, you know, look, Trump is putting children in cages. It's the perfect issue for us. Because we don't have to talk about immigration reform. We don't really have to have a debate. It's just about the cruelty of this one man. Time magazine has its sort of iconic Time cover. Not that anyone gives a shit about Time magazine anymore, but they tried with the child. They sort of photoshopped the child crying, a helpless child with Trump glowering above the child. And it worked out really well at first for the Democrats. They turned to their channels, you know, their, you know, DNC bots like Joy Reid and Maddow, you know, fake cried. It seemed to be going really well. Trump was put on the defensive. He had to issue an executive order after, you know, trying to own it and double down on putting kids in cages. And his approval rating plummeted. But something else happened that I think was troubling for the Democratic Party establishment, which was the civility debate, you know, the heckling of members of the Trump administration in restaurants in Washington, the same restaurants that like MXDC is like block from the White House. It's the same restaurants that, you know, Schumer and Nancy Pelosi eat at, and they all hang out together. They might not hang out with Stephen Miller, but like I saw Pelosi 2 weeks ago praise George W. Bush as a great president at an event. I'll release that video later. Basically, the people suddenly came out for the first time in the Trump administration since those early days when there were protests at Trump Hotel and there were those major resistance protests. And this sort of wild wind that has been suppressed for the whole Trump administration, it rose again. It sort of was blowing again, and it frightened the Democratic leadership. Then you saw the election of Ocasio defeating Joe Crowley, and on the heels of this moment, basically what the Democrats had done is they had they'd attacked Trump from the left, introduced a real issue that had much deeper roots, and they turned their progressive base loose, something that they're actually afraid of doing. And what they had done since Trump had come in, I think, was an effort to suppress real opposition, not just to Trump, but to the system that created a figure like Trump, the same system that, produced Occupy, Black Lives Matter, and all these other movements in reaction to it. And they'd done it through Russiagate. I mean, we've talked about the politics of Russiagate extensively on this program, on our little podcast. But what Russiagate does is it takes the base of the party and it takes the sort of activist base and turns it, it reduces them to spectators. And it also forces everyone, or tries to compel everyone, to come out and defend our institutions, especially our most conservative institutions like the FBI, against Donald Trump and the congressional Republicans. And so it's been very convenient, not only as a way of attacking Trump, but as a way of silencing the left, and silencing the organic resistance to not just Trump, but what Trump represents. And so the Democrats created this crisis for themselves, and they couldn't put the monster back in the box. And that's where the civility debate came from. So I'm just thinking that they're not comfortable with this moment right now. And there's going to be another effort to either reignite Russiagate or shift the debate to something else. But now we're on to a new freakout, which is much more convenient for the centrist establishment. And I think they're going to try to kind of hold the line there, because the consequences of taking on Trump from the left are too much for a Democratic Party that hopes to return to power and continue policies of mass deportation.
Yeah, I think that's a great note to end on. I mean, Max, you hit all the points hit the nail right in the head. Unfortunately, we've seen again and again that the Democratic Party will continue getting everything wrong until it's exhausted all other possibilities, and then it will finally get the right policy after being dragged to that policy. And we're seeing it now. So unfortunately, we don't have too many positive things to end on, but I think we can look at people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. We'll see when she gets a chance to govern how she does.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. And we'll see if she puts up her foreign policy platform again.
Yeah. So thank you for listening to and maybe even watching our show. If you'd like to support the original journalism Max and I are doing, and if you'd like to help us do even more episodes more frequently, you can support us on our Patreon. That is patreon.com/moderaterebels. A little bit of support goes a long way, so please consider helping to sustain our work there. You can just contribute a few dollars every month. Again, a lot of people combining, it goes a really long way, even if you're just giving a little. And you can also find us on social media and help follow us and spread our material there. Of course, we're on Twitter and Facebook. We're also increasingly active on YouTube. You can go to youtube.com/moderaterebels. Thanks for listening to and watching our show. This was Moderate Rebels.